you.
It's been a little while.
Yeah.
Well,
everything will be
actually,
in this
I came
room.
To the board meeting.
Oh, yes, you're at the board meeting.
I think when I called, I kept my distance. I was over there, and then you guys stayed and hung around afterwards, so all good.
Let me get my name tag.
Yep, Kathy Brister.
Hi, Nydia.
Good morning, Kathy.
How are you?
I'm doing very well.
Thank you. Good morning.
I'm sorry, you're going to have to tell me your name again.
Dana.
Dana. Oh. We met. You were at Welcome, right? Did you work at Welcome?
I have in the past.
I don't think she did this last year.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I don't think so.
You look familiar. I think we've met at some point.
I'm sure that you have.
Good morning. My name is Richard Griffiths. I'm a Georgia First Amendment Foundation board member. And I'd like to welcome everybody to the 32nd Bar, Media, and Judiciary Conference. It's the third year that the conference is presented with the organizational support of the foundation. This conference was originally conceived by some judges and journalists as a way to get real conversations going between those justices and journalists and lawyers that don't always see eye to eye. The goal was to help all three groups better understand the others, their motivations, and also the political, judicial, and legal challenges they face and the state of Georgia faces. We have a really terrific program for the day. For the full rundown, you can go to the QR code or type in the bit.ly and get the rundown. You can get the bios, and you can get the additional supplemental materials, which there's quite a bit. We will have a working lunch today, and we'll let you know when those box lunches are in so you can go get yours before all of the vegetarian ones or the ones with extra mustard disappear. I also want to remind everybody that there will be a reception at the end of the day, a good opportunity for some networking, good opportunity to meet the organizers and tell us what we should do better for next year, and your fellow participants. My big job today is going to try to keep the trains running on time and trying to make sure we are keeping somewhat close to the schedule. Particularly around lunchtime, we've got a taping with WABE, and so we need to be really precise about that time. And so if we ask you to get back to your seats, please get back to your seats. Now I want to talk about the sponsors whose contributions go so far as to support this conference. The names are now on the screen: the Georgia First Amendment Foundation, CNN, big sponsor, the State Bar of Georgia, which gives us enormous support in setting up this conference, and the space, and your parking. So thanks very much to the State Bar and to Jones Day. And you see the other many generous sponsors on that list. This conference would not have been pulled together if it was not for the tireless work of the volunteers that you see on the screen. It's a lot of volunteers. A lot of hard work goes into this conference. I want to especially thank Peter Canfield from Jones Day, who patiently guides this committee through the preparation of this event. Now we'll turn to the kickoff panel of the conference. I want to introduce UGA Professor Claire Norins, who's also on the board with me at the Georgia First Amendment Foundation. Professor Norins is the director of the First Amendment Clinic at UGA Law School. She'll be presenting a panel on something near and very dear to my heart, open government in Georgia. Claire, take it away.
Thank you, Richard, and thank you all for being here. It's really nice to be in person. I came to this in 2020, I think the last time it was in person, and that was my first Bar Media Conference. So really glad to be here and be presenting this panel. So starting at the end, we have Sonam Vashi with us, who is an award-winning local journalist from Atlanta. She's been published in the New York Times, ProPublica, Atlanta Magazine, The Washington Post, National Geographic, and others. She is a co-founder and co-director of Canopy Atlanta, which is a community-led nonprofit newsroom where stories are chosen and produced and presented with local residents, which I think is a really innovative and wonderful project. In 2022, she was a John S. Knight Community Impact Fellow. She has a bachelor's degree in political science and journalism from Emory University. And today she's here representing the Atlanta Documenters Program, which pays and trains residents to report on undercovered public meetings in the Metro Atlanta area. So thank you, Sonam, for being here. Also with us today is Joy Ramsingh, who runs her own firm. She has a niche practice across multiple jurisdictions that focuses on government transparency issues. And before starting her own firm, Joy worked at a state agency in Pennsylvania where she was tasked with enforcing the state's public record laws there. And in that role, she issued hundreds of binding legal opinions in public records appeals. She was also an appellate attorney in a transparency law firm practice in Philadelphia, and she currently lives in Macon, Georgia, and is in the process of waving into the Georgia bar, which I did myself, so I feel your pain there. And then I also have today with us Jennifer Colangelo, who is an assistant attorney general with the state of Georgia, and she's been in that role since 2012. And she works in the Employment, Education, and Government Services section, where she handles matters for clients like the Georgia Department of Education, the State Charter School Commission, the Professional Standards Commission, and the Office of Bar Admissions, which is interesting for us lawyers. She also works on the Attorney General's Open Government Mediation Program. And in that capacity, she helps citizens and agencies resolve problems that arise over open meetings and open records compliance issues. Before joining the Attorney General's office, she was an assistant public defender in Enoda, the noted judicial circuit, and she attended Rutgers University in New Jersey before relocating to Georgia. So thank you so much, Jennifer, for being with us. So this panel is going to focus on open government and access issues in Georgia, particularly focused around public records, public meetings, and court proceedings, judicial filings. So Sonam, I'm gonna start with you. In addition to founding Canopy, which is a local newsroom, you also started the Atlanta Documenters Program. And can you tell us a little bit more about that program, what it does, and how it promotes access and transparency related to government meetings?
Yeah, absolutely, thanks so much. You know, I think public meetings are workshops for democracy. They're spaces that are places where people are committing acts of democracy every day. But I think, and this has, you know, changed in different ways during the pandemic, but in talking to so many different residents, what we found is that public meetings can also be spaces that are very intimidating. If you don't know what a motion is, the difference between an ordinance or a resolution, they can be inaccessible in ways that can engender distrust. And they can be hard to find and difficult to follow for people. There are these barriers that go beyond the legal that we've seen and that we've seen have affected trust in a lot of different residents, and especially in residents in neighborhoods that are primarily communities of color and lower wealth communities. And so what we do is we take these, you know, almost empty meetings in some cases, these undercover public boards, commissions, and we pay and train residents to go to them, to take notes, and to share that with their neighbors. We think this is a crucial opportunity for genuine democracy every day. So what we do is we've started this program late last year. We've trained more than 100 residents and covered more than 100 public meetings across Metro Atlanta. We focus on meetings in which the declining opportunities for local reporters to cover, you know, these are still spaces that we need information. And so residents have filled the gaps. We've seen Atlanta documenters cover meetings in a way that in which they're the only public record of what has happened at a specific meeting, and that has helped power the work of other journalists, other organizations, and other community members. We've seen the amount of trust that has been built as well in systems that already exist, and also small changes that have happened by simply having residents in the room, whether it's officials starting to explain certain terms they're using, or simply just putting more accessible options online in other spaces.
And just a couple of follow-up questions with that. Are you sending the same residents to the same agency meetings so that they get familiar with the issues and people get to know them as a regular observer, or do they switch it up and go to different meetings?
It definitely depends on the documenter, but it is a program that is open to for anyone to apply to. We obviously, you know, take some conflicts of interest pretty seriously, but some folks really want to have that informal beat reporting experience, really get to know an agency very deeply. It's very helpful, especially for our more complex agencies, planning, zoning, these spaces where you do need to know quite a bit of terminology. Other folks do want to get just a smattering of what's going on in their local, you know, town, municipality. And so we do actually focus on a lot of, especially Metro Atlanta, there's so many different patchworks of governments. We have so many different cities almost every year, it seems like that are forming. And so we find that actually residents don't even know sometimes who has jurisdiction over their street, their neighborhood.
And can you talk a little bit about what happens after the documenter goes and takes their notes from the meeting? Like, what are the next steps? What happens with that information?
Sure, yeah. We are a journalist organization, so what we do is that we offer a lot of training and support on the front end. But what ends up happening is that when a resident goes to their first public meeting sometimes, they are overwhelmed, they have no idea what just happened. And so we always have an editing process that's pretty substantial. We're fact-checking all the information that's being published on documenters.org. We're working with residents to help break down some of the jargon, some of the processes, the parliamentary procedures, so that they can understand what's going on.
Great. Well, that's a really exciting program. And does it exist in other places besides the Metro Atlanta area?
Absolutely. This is a program that was started by a group called City Bureau in Chicago. This program is now expanding all across the country. I think we got a $10 million grant last year to do them. It is run by local organizations like Canopy Atlanta across different cities, but we are the first such program in the U.S. South at this point.
Well, congratulations to you on getting that started. So Jennifer, turning to you, you work with the Attorney General's Open Government Mediation Program that receives complaints from citizens who have an issue with their local agency not complying or allegedly not complying with either the Open Records Act or the Open Meetings Act. And can you just talk to us a little bit about how your program operates and sort of what authority you have to enforce these sunshine laws?
So the mediation program itself is pretty informal. We have a form on our webpage where people can submit a complaint, identify what local government they have a problem with, if they're having trouble getting records, if they saw something in a meeting that didn't seem quite right, they just submit a description to us. Lots of people have my email address and my phone number, and sometimes they just contact me directly. People just go up to me and talk to me, and I say, send me an email and we'll look into it. And most of the time, we just try to solve the problems informally. The Attorney General does have the authority to bring lawsuits. The Attorney General himself can bring a lawsuit against a local government that's violating the acts. We can bring civil lawsuits, and every now and then, do a criminal charge. We did one not too long ago in Atlanta. But most of the time, we try to avoid spending taxpayers' money on lawyers fighting each other. And most of the time, the violations that we see are not intentional. I mean, there are some, but most of the time, it's people who just don't understand the law. Maybe they've had training 20 years ago, and they're not up to date with the latest changes, and they just need to be educated, get some training, get a little pep talk about the importance of open government, understand why it matters, that requests be responded to within 3 days, that sort of thing.
And so, short of bringing a lawsuit against an agency or an official at an agency, what are some of the sort of less aggressive steps that your program can take to encourage compliance?
Occasionally, what we'll do is, just short of filing a lawsuit, we'll sign sort of a settlement agreement with a local government where they admit in writing that they violated the law and they pay a fine. But again, it's been a while since we've seen a really intentional egregious violation. A lot of times, what I'll do is just offer some training. I'll say, it seems like the mayor doesn't really understand what this is all about or think it's important, or you've got a lot of new people in the clerk's office and they don't seem to know what they're doing. Why don't I come down and one of my colleagues come down and we'll give you some training. And just when, you know, somebody from the Attorney General's office shows up in your small town and lectures you about the Open Records Act and the Open Meetings Act, I think it just kind of makes an impression on people and makes them realize this is something important, something that people are paying attention to. They really are paying attention to all over your state, your agendas and your meeting minutes and how long it takes them to get records.
And so I'm sure you receive complaints on a variety of different issues arising under open meetings and open records. What do you see as the sort of most important types of complaints to take action on?
I don't think that there's a particular type of complaint in the sense that violating the three-day rule is more important than some other aspect of the Open Records Act. It's more the cause of the violation. You know, sometimes we have public officials maybe who are very new to office or have been in office for a very long time and think that they know how to do things and don't need the state coming and telling them how they're supposed to run their meetings. So the situations where people are a little bit resistant at first, those are the things that are important to us to make sure that everybody not just knows the law, but knows why they need to follow it and starts to get an understanding of how it can benefit them.
And once you've resolved an issue in the short term, is there any sort of monitoring that occurs of that particular agency, or do you just turn them loose and wait for the next complaint, or hopefully not a next complaint?
We don't really have enough personnel to do monitoring.
Sure.
Generally, what'll happen is if the local media knows that I've been down to, say, give a talk to their city council or their county commission, they'll know that they can contact me if they have a problem with something that happens in the future. Or the local citizens who have Facebook pages and blogs and who do their own reporting on meetings and things will know that the Attorney General's office will be interested to hear if something is going wrong.
Yeah.
So we simply start getting more complaints from people if things are not going as they should, even after we've given training.
Right. And the press play an important role in sort of letting folks know that there's an issue. You talk about person power. How large is the Open Government Mediation Program in terms of staff?
There's really just two of us working on it.
Well, I think that's important for people to know, too, because you have a beautiful website, and people might think, like, oh, there's a small army of people doing this, and that's not the case. So, Joy, your private practice focuses on government transparency, primarily in the area of public records and public meetings, but you've also recently undertaken a pro bono project on behalf of the Georgia First Amendment Foundation to try to unseal court records related to contracts awarded by the Georgia Access to Medical Cannabis Commission. A small number of contracts was awarded to a select group of manufacturers, and some of the losing bidders have sued over how those contracts were awarded. And the records in that proceeding have been sealed. So can you tell us why public access to court records in this particular instance is important, but also just more globally, why access to court documents is an important aspect of government transparency?
Well, let's start with more globally. And I think that to understand this, the best thing we can do is look at history. In the 1400s, England came up with this special court. And the idea was great. It was going to be an anti-corruption court. They were going to have a special court where aristocrats and prominent people could be tried separately from the commoners, because the idea was that ordinary judges wouldn't want to convict these people. And in the courtroom, they had a blue ceiling with these little gold stars. They called it the Star Chamber. The problem was the whole anti-corruption mission failed because they didn't have Uniform Superior Court Rule 21. They came up with these proceedings, these procedures, where a court examiner would take a witness into a room and would take down their testimony, but the witness's lawyer didn't get to know what they said, and the public certainly didn't get to know what they said. So you can imagine what happened. All kinds of arbitrary, irregular, inconsistent decisions came out of this courtroom, and monarchs used it for their nefarious purposes to get convictions and things like that. So what we learned from that experience, from that experiment really, is that justice is not justice in private. There's no way to ensure justice when it happens in private. So that court was disbanded, I think, in 1640, but we're fighting the battle for access to court records right now in 2023 in Georgia on these medical cannabis records. And that battle happens every single time a court hears a motion to unseal court records. So why it matters more particularly in this instance is that we're dealing with an issue of public health. You know, imagine a situation where, you know, some suffering patient gets a defective medical cannabis product and they suffer some kind of catastrophic injury, right? And then we find out later that there was a quality control issue with the product that perhaps could have been prevented by a more transparent licensing process. I think any time you're dealing with the quality of health care that individuals are receiving, it matters. You know, medical cannabis is a very small kind of niche thing to talk about in the global hemisphere of all of the different laws in Georgia. But it matters in principle, and it matters in practice to the patients, I think.
Sure. And is there also a financial rationale for why there would be ideally transparency with the award of these contracts?
Of course. I mean, you know, you're talking about a situation. Medical cannabis is an extremely lucrative industry. And I think that it's interesting that in this particular case, there seems to have been a push to treat this industry differently than a lot of other industries. You know, right now in Georgia, there are all kinds of contracts that are being awarded to government contractors, and those are not subject to the same, I guess, standards for sealing. And that's something that kind of baffles me, because there are certain, and then of course, yes, taxpayers deserve to know what's happening. But even if you're, the financial thing to me is separate from the idea of justice and the idea that you cannot have justice in a private courtroom.
Absolutely. And so in this case, the sealing of the records occurred in large part because the Georgia legislature had created an exception to the Open Records Act for Cannabis Commission, most of the Cannabis Commission records, meaning that they would not be accessible through an open records request. And can you talk to us a little bit about how the creation of statutory exemptions or exceptions to the Open Records Act not only reduces access to records, but also kind of lays the groundwork for reducing access in other contexts?
Yeah, I think that's an important question, because I think a lot of times lawmakers, they draft laws, and of course the consequences are sometimes completely unforeseen, how far that can go. In this case, you know, the procedure to get records under the Open Records Act and from agencies, and the procedure to get records from the judiciary under procedural rules and under the common law constitutional right of access to court records, those are two completely different standards, and they're two completely different sets of procedures. The HOPE Act, the medical cannabis law, says absolutely nothing about sealing judicial records, that it's completely silent on that issue. And the legislature knows how to write the words, these records should be sealed, because they've done it in plenty of other statutes. So thinking about like adoption records and juvenile records and grand jury witness testimonies and different things like that, there's all kinds of records where the legislature said these should be sealed. They didn't say that with the HOPE Act. It's just, it says, shall be confidential data and shall not be accessible under the Open Records Act. So I think in this case, what we've seen though is that because of the sort of ambiguous phrase, shall be confidential data, there's been this reluctance to say, well, you know, we're not going to parse through and make this determination, or we're not going to weigh what we you know, the public interest in disclosure against the privacy interest, because we're not sure we think the legislature intended for this to be private. They've already declared this privacy interest, and I think that that I think that there's a little bit of conflation of the two processes, and we're hoping, of course, that the legislature you know, remedy some of that.
Yes, and there is hope that that may happen.
Yes.
So Sonam, jumping back to you, with respect to the open meetings that Documenters observes and reports out on, you talked a little bit about some of the barriers that your staff have encountered in terms of being able to follow along at meetings and understand the jargon and sort of grasp what the issues are, even though they're not being explained explicitly. You were also operating, in fact, you started operating Documenters during the pandemic. And so I'm just wondering what barriers to access you encountered because of COVID, and if those barriers have resolved or if they're continuing now that we are moving into a post-pandemic world.
Yes. You know, I think one thing, and this goes to both during and after the pandemic, is about the reliability of remote access. I think what we've seen in a lot of spaces is that as the actual board or committee or commission has transitioned back into in-person, the remote access element that used to be the way that the meetings were actually held has either dropped off or has been deprioritized. And so we saw this most recently, and I know the clinic and the First Amendment Foundation has been involved with this to some extent with the Forest Park City Council, where Robin Kemp of the Clayton Crescent has been doing such great work. She had an experience where once the Forest Park City Council went back into in-person meetings, they still had a live stream going on, but they would not allow Robin, a journalist, to enter the meeting. And their live stream is very unreliable. It's very faulty. It was, you know, half the time it didn't work. So really there was an access issue going on there. And that still has continued to happen with some of our Documenters, where even though now members of the public are allowed into the chambers, even though the remote access is advertised, half the time it doesn't work. I have to send a prayer every time we assign a Documenter to it. This is why we also have to pay more for our Documenters to attend meetings in person, because that's sometimes the only way we can ensure that the meeting will actually be visible and accessible. So I think this is also a case that we see a lot of times in smaller municipalities or in meetings that are not as high priority for a lot of media, is when no one's there, there's really not an incentive to make this happen until they start hearing complaints. And so, you know, in the Forest Park situation, I think just by sending Documenters and making complaints among many other journalists, they've now invested money into having a better Zoom stream. And I think it's just a really great example of how when that access is prioritized, not only by our elected officials, but also, you know, when citizens make it clear that this is a priority, change can actually happen. And I'm also just, you know, just reminded by how creative and, you know, despite many failures on this level, it was really truly stunning how many public agencies were able to quickly pivot at the beginning of the pandemic. We were able to keep democracy going. And so it's also a reminder to me that we can do this. We can do it if we prioritize it. So I think that's been the major issue.
Well, it's interesting because during COVID, obviously, a lot of agencies did have to pivot and provide either telephone access or live streaming or Zoom access to their meetings to comply with the Open Meetings Act. And now that things are back in person once again, You know, the law doesn't require agencies to offer remote access, and so some have chosen not to continue it so that you do have to come in person. And I'm just wondering from your experience, obviously there's a lot of benefits to providing remote access. It makes it easier for people to tune in and see what's going on from the comfort of their own home. Do you see any negatives to offering remote access? And kind of the flip side of that, do you think the law should be amended to require remote access in addition to in-person accessibility?
I think the benefits of providing remote access are, I think the drawbacks are few, I would say that. That being said, you know, especially for those meetings, and there are several, at least in Metro Atlanta, where the only option is remote access, I think there is something lost in and there not being a way for residents to interact with their elected officials or representatives. You know, for example, some meetings continue to only accept public comment in the form of a written email. It's just very different when you're forced to kind of be face-to-face with somebody, or, you know, when someone is as physically present. I think the benefits of that in-person interaction are really important. That being said, you know, for many people, we are still in the pandemic, and so I really understand why some meetings are continue to be remote access. I just think we can be a little more creative about how we can get residents there a little bit more. The second thing that comes to mind is are the ways in which remote access, the burden of providing it has sometimes fallen, especially in some of these smaller agencies, on these resident-led groups without enough support. One thing that comes to mind, and this is kind of a gray area, I know, with whether this falls under the Open Meetings Act, is our Atlanta's Neighborhood Planning Unit system. So this is a resident-led group of 25 different neighborhood boards, basically, that have an official role in Atlanta's planning process. And these are resident-led groups that must that host many of their meetings on Zoom. There have been a lot of instances of that not working very well, or the meeting chair kicking people out. A lot of that is a training element, but I also think about how, you know, especially these smaller institutions, these are groups of residents. They may not know have a skill level or technological ability to know how to host on Zoom or host remotely in a way that that works and complies with the law. And so I think about, you know, are we providing enough, whether it's financial, technological support, to make sure remote access is happening, and where is that burden falling?
And where do you come down on whether it should be a legal requirement that they provide access remotely?
I do think there should be a legal requirement for just greater accessibility, period. I think remote access is so important, not only for, you know, in places like Metro Atlanta, where the question of whether a public meeting is accessible is sometimes dependent on the amount of traffic you have to get through to attend. You know, these are real barriers. So I do think it should be a legal requirement. But more than that, I think we just need some cultural reform in some of these public meeting spaces. Who are these spaces really for, and what are they accessible to the people we actually want to be in here?
Mm-hmm. Great. So Jennifer, turning back to you and changing subjects a little bit, many states are adopting laws that prohibit disclosing the personal identifying information of public employees, including their addresses, even if the information is contained in a public record that doesn't identify the person as being a public employee. So for instance, like copies of utility bills, where the bill doesn't say who the account owner works for or whether they're a public employee, but to produce that as a public record, it would have to be first redacted. And we also have a bill right now pending in the Georgia legislature, SB 212, that would similarly require redaction of all personal identifying information of public employees from public records. And so I'm curious what your perspective is on, if this bill were passed, how that would impact agencies who have to respond to open records requests, and also how it would impact the people who are requesting the public records.
I think the obvious problem is how on earth do you how on earth will a city clerk or someone like that look at a record and figure out, how do they know if that utility bill belongs to someone who's a public employee? I don't know the answer to that. But I think moving forward, one thing that would be pretty easy for everybody to do is simply for all of our government agencies to update their forms and just have a little checkbox where you can check off if you're a public employee. And then our clerks who are responding to open records requests could just look at the checkbox and see if they need to redact anything. Let's see, you could also have your public employees submit written requests to a city and say, I'm a public employee, please go through your records and make sure that you don't release my information. And one thing that might be nice to see in the future is everybody may be rethinking how much information they really need to collect. Do people really need to put their addresses on every single one of these forms? You know, it's just sort of standard. You have a form for people to pull out, it has to fill out, it's got all this stuff at the top, and it always asks for your address, but does it really need to be on the form? Maybe we don't need to collect some of this personal information about people and have it in our government records for other people to somehow get to.
So you have some ideas for how, like, we could cope with this law if it were passed. What do you think the burden would be, though, on folks having to comply with it before we've implemented some of these reforms that you just suggested?
I think it's going to be an awfully big burden, unfortunately, just because we don't have the people. Agencies just don't have the information they need to look at something like utility bills and make those redactions for public employees when they don't know who the public employees are.
Would it be fair to say that it's just going to be a lot more time consuming for the people who have to produce the records, which may delay the records coming out or result in fees associated with the time of having to go through the records and try to find all that information and react to it?
I hope not. I hope that you know, somebody smarter than me has already started thinking up a good solution to this. That's what I'm kind of counting on.
So other states' public records laws include, or some other states' public records laws include a fee waiver provision where depending on the type of request and the purpose of the request, the person may be, exempted from having to pay the fee associated with the time of collecting the records and doing any necessary redactions. Georgia doesn't currently have such a provision in our Open Records Act. What's your view on that? Do you think that's appropriate to include? And if so, like, what sorts of circumstances would you support having a fee waiver option?
I think part of the purpose of the way that Georgia's fee schedule is set up is to you can either look at it as discouraging people from making very large requests or encouraging them to make small requests. If somebody makes a request and they get back a cost estimate of $10,000, it's probably because they've asked for way too many records. And it will take government employees hours and hours to produce those records. And we really don't want, you know, a city clerk to have to spend hours and hours and hours working on one single request, pushing off all the other requests, and then not getting reimbursed for it and sort of indirectly passing the costs on to taxpayers. So I'm not sure that we need really any changes in that respect. If we did want to make things a little bit easier for requesters who intend to make small requests or make requests that don't seem so big to them, but even a few hundred dollars is a little too much for them to afford. I mean, right now we have a free 15 minutes for every request, but we could certainly increase that to free 30 minutes or something like that.
Sure. Another issue that we see sometimes with open records work that the clinic does is this standard in the law that the records be produced as soon as practicable. Ideally within 3 business days, but if that's not possible, the statute says as soon as practicable and doesn't really define what practicable is, because of course it's going to vary depending on the type of request and the volume, etc. I'm curious what your view is on that standard, whether that's a good standard to have, and how you sort of counsel agencies about what is practicable, like what's the Attorney General's definition of practicable?
for example, I tell city clerk, you know, if somebody comes in and says, can I get a copy of the minutes from last week's meeting? They should be close at hand. There should be no reason they can't immediately put them on the photocopier, copy them real quick and hand them over. You know, agencies shouldn't just say it's going to be 3 days just because they can. There are records that are very quick and easy to produce, and they should produce those quickly. And then on the other hand, sometimes people don't understand that some agencies will sort of get bogged down with requests, and so somebody will say, it shouldn't take you very long to get those records. For me, I have such a simple request, and the agency says, well, there's 10 other people in front of you that have asked for their records first, and we've got to get through all of them before we can do yours. I'm sorry.
And related to that, do you have any thoughts on whether it would make sense to sort of require agencies to post the open records requests that they've received and whether or not they've been fulfilled, just to have more transparency about the volume and who's in the queue ahead of you, and also what else has been requested by other people that maybe would be easy for you to re-request or even could be just made available de facto so that nobody has to make the same open records request twice to the same agency?
I'm pretty sure that the agencies that use some of the software packages like GovQA, I forget what the other ones are called, those software packages have that built into them, where I think agencies could just select that feature to implement, and everybody's open records requests and their responses are all up there. Another thing that I think should be pretty simple for almost any agency to do is just post more of their documents online. Many, many, you know, boards and commissions post their agendas and their meeting minutes online. Let's get a lot more stuff up there. Let's get audits and citations and budgets, and there's all sorts of things that could very easily be posted online so that people don't even have to make requests.
And are these suggestions that your office is in a position to suggest to people, or are
we do that informally?
Yeah. Would you ever consider like putting some sort of guidance on your website about stuff like that?
Sure.
I know that would be helpful for us to have as a source to cite. We refer people a lot to your FAQs, which are really helpful. So Joy, going back to court records, you talked about the importance of transparency for justice to occur, and the idea that there needs to be sort of public trust in the judicial process and that it's working correctly. Court transparency is also really important for holding private parties accountable for instance, like exposing through litigation the harm that a private party may have caused or their level of culpability. And I'm thinking particularly of like mass tort cases like the multi-district litigation against tobacco companies for their manufacture and marketing of cigarettes, or against the Sackler family and Purdue Pharma for their role in the opioid crisis. And oftentimes there's a move by the private litigants to keep this information out of the public eye. So can you explain some of the tactics that private litigants will use to try to keep court filings secret or sealed, and what tools exist, particularly in Georgia, to combat those attempts at secrecy?
Sure. So, well, of course, if information doesn't get to the court in the first place, then it doesn't fall under the point of access to judicial records. So one of the ways that private litigants will try to avoid exposing things through litigation is just not to go to litigation in the first place. A lot of contracts have mandatory alternative dispute resolution processes, maybe mediation or arbitration or something that would result in a settlement agreement that then becomes private. And we see this a lot, you know, that you can request a protective order during discovery and things like that. You can enter into an agreed protective order. The other thing is that you can just try to block discovery from happening in the first place. I think one of the more recent examples is there's a Meghan Markle case that's pending in Florida. I think she's, and one of her family members sued her for defamation, and then she ended up filing a motion to dismiss and then filing a motion to stay discovery in case it got dismissed, with the idea being that she wouldn't have to be deposed, and then that transcript wouldn't be filed with the court, and then it wouldn't become a court record. So one of, I think, the most powerful ways. And then, of course, motions to seal the record or trying to file things under seal. There are tools, right, that citizens can use to access these records. The most common, of course, is the motion to unseal. The problem with the motion to unseal is that it's almost always a catch-22. You know, for example, whether or not a record has been filed under seal, but you don't know what's in the record. So it's really difficult to explain, well, this is an important record and we need this record, because you don't know what's in the record in the first place. So I think that the real first line of defense are the judges. I mean, a good judiciary that really understands the constitutional underpinnings of court access, that is, they're the keepers of the flame, because the best thing is when records don't get sealed in the first place. You know, because some of the tools that are available to citizens are only so effective. And I'll plug the First Amendment Foundation's Yellow Book here. It's a great resource for citizens to access and to learn about accessing court records. But yeah, I think that ultimately what's different about court records from the Open Records Act is that the judges really have an obligation as gatekeepers to prevent that from happening in the first place.
And we have, Superior Court Rule 21 in Georgia that sets certain standards and procedures for judges to follow before sealing. Since you do practice in a multi-jurisdictional firm, how does that rule sort of stack up against maybe other states' rules for sealing?
I have been impressed largely by Georgia. And Superior Court Rule 21, sure, but what Rule 21 really is it's a codification of your common law. And Georgia's common law, I mean, you have incredible quotes from jurists going back for decades that talk about how fundamental and, you know, our system abhors star chamber proceedings and, you know, this is fundamental and, you know, public officials are amenable at all times, the Constitution says. And so this has been really woven into the fabric of Georgia. The Georgia right of access to court records is more robust than the federal right, which is incredible to me. But I have been largely impressed by Georgia. I think, though, just like I said, I think that every single time a motion to unseal comes up, that battle sort of starts from scratch, because there's always a reason to seal a record. You know, litigants are embarrassed. The information's confidential. Well, sure, there's tons of information that might be subjectively confidential to you. That doesn't mean that it's confidential under the objective standard weighed against the public interest in disclosure. So those sorts of discretionary decisions that judges are making, it's not so much whether you have a good procedural rule or a good common law background. It's about how it gets applied each and every time the issue comes up.
Well, I'm gratified to hear that we stack up fairly well compared to other states. So this is a question for all of you. A couple of times it's been mentioned that education is really key in terms of securing compliance with open records and open meetings laws. And so I'd love for you to sort of talk from your individual perspectives about who should be educated and who should be doing the education.
Yeah, I mean, I'm happy to speak on that. we do a lot of education in all directions and are constantly learning myself, I would say that way. So, this comes up a lot with documenters, especially folks who are going to their first public meeting, where we have documenters fill out a checklist every time they take an assignment. And that checklist involves a lot of questions, including, were officials courteous to each other? Usually, not always. Was the space accessible? Again, usually, not always. But also, were decisions made in advance? Or did it feel like decisions were made in advance of the meeting? And that one is probably checked more than 80% of the time. And I think that's a great example of education in kind of all directions. Especially for county commissions, large city councils, we do not want 80-hour meetings where officials have to have every discussion about a particular ordinance or piece of legislation in the open necessarily. So there is some work that happens outside of that, right? Whether it speaks into a committee or the kind of back and forth politicking that happens. I think some of that is about educating residents, right? Here's why, you know, things go on a consent agenda and get voted on together. It's because we want to keep things moving. And then I think the other way around educating our elected officials, our kind of institutions, really comes up with, you know, when a particular agency is voting unanimously all the time, or going to executive sessions in ways that are maybe an abuse of that. Understanding how that looks to the public. I think, you know, there's this, weighing the efficiency and the protection, particularly around an executive session, around how much mistrust is this creating with public residents? Are you actually taking time to explain to your constituents about why you're making the decision to vote yes or no in the public eye in ways that are that explain it to them? So I think it really goes all ways in that way.
Can I add something?
Yes, I was hoping you would, yeah.
So our office does lots of trainings and presentations for local governments, things like that. I know the First Amendment Foundation does lots of trainings. And a lot of times people will just call me up, you know, someone at a city or a sheriff's office will call me up and say, we've got some new people, can you come give us a training? And I say, I'd be happy to, we just set it up informally. But it would be great if like a citizens group would call me and say, could you come do a training for us? I would love it if just groups of people who want to know more would call me up and ask me to do some trainings for them. I'd happily do that.
Great. Well, as someone who's involved with those trainings that the Georgia First Amendment Foundation does, we would love for you to participate with us in those. And thank you for coming to our last one. Okay, well, I think we are out of time, so I just want to thank all three of you for being here and being on the early panel, and look forward to talking more about these issues. So thanks a lot.
Thank you, everybody. Next panel, come on up. Fantastic day. A few items before we head to the reception. I want to again thank our sponsors. In particular, again, I want to thank the bar who make this space available to us, who give us so much support through the year. And again, for that fabulous parking. When you have the opportunity on your way out, please thank them. I also want to thank the planning committee members that have worked so hard to pull this event together. And there's one name at the top of the list there I want to thank. It's written in small type, so I've blown it up just a little bit. Peter Canfield is our planning committee chair. The first conference was in 1989. We skipped a couple of years, one very early, and then one after 9/11, but guiding this effort through the last 30 years, 30 conferences, has been Peter Canfield. It is his labor of love, corralling plenty of type A lawyers, judges, and journalists, getting them on a committee, getting them to work together towards a program that educates, informs, and challenges. We owe Peter a huge debt of gratitude. Please step up here for a moment.
Thanks. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Let's go get a drink.
I just want to thank you again for your help on that podcast.
Well, it wasn't very much help.
It was help to us.
It's great to see you. I will